What's good, my beautiful people? I hope everyone is doing fine and in good spirits. So welcome to SK Wealth Academy podcast number 131. Avoid succumbing to humanity destroying fear. Now, this podcast actually might be the most important one I've released in the past several weeks. I know a lot of you only follow my financial videos, but I hope each and every one of you will watch this one to the very end because I have a lot of important things about my observations about how so many of us are losing our humanity during the self-isolation bubbles that have been mandated by the parasitic ruling class that lord over us. Now, every one of us should be living our lives in a way that many people will remember us long after we're gone from this world for our humanity. So if you can say that about yourself right now, then you are definitely living the proper way because we are not put on this earth to brag about our material possessions, to upload all our material wealth for those of us to be jealous on Instagram, to accumulate as much material wealth as possible. That's the immoral delusion taught to us by the ruling class, but it's a very illegitimate reason that explains why we're here on planet Earth. We're not even here to procreate, as a lot of people have also heard people say, the only purpose we're here on life is to procreate. Again, wrong. The reason we're put on earth is to be humane to one another, to care for one another, to help one another. And that does not mean to exercise these principles among only people we know, but to exercise these principles among people we do not know as well, because all life on planet Earth is connected. Red, white, yellow, brown, black, we're all each other's brothers and sisters. Leopards, wolves, orcas, dogs, we're all keepers and protectors of life on this planet. So we all need to check in with the people we care about far more often than most of us do. Now, some of you may be the best friend in the world to your circle of friends, but I know I've been guilty of not being a solid friend at times, even though if they needed me in emergencies, they know I would be there for them 100%, but that is not good enough, because, and I will explain why. People may say they understood my focus on myself during this lockdown period that's, 155 days and counting or whatever it is, but I'm not going to go into the reasons for this, but I've actually had zero access to any of my savings during this lockdown, either fiat currencies or precious metals. So precious metals is a given. I don't have access to that, but to that store. But fiat currencies, people would be like, why don't you have access to your bank accounts? That's another story. I don't really want to get into it, but I haven't. So I had to actually befriend someone first in the city where I've been stuck during my travel lockdown that has a local bank account just so I could transfer money I needed into her bank account and then receive that money. She could withdraw and then give it to me. So the stranded on the desert analogy I've used with having to figure out how to survive during these 155 plus days was real. But even then, I knew that because of the circle of friends and family that I had built over time, that in reality, I was never going to starve to death or be living on the streets, even with no access to any money. Because during the first couple months of my travel lockdown, I didn't check up on people that I'm normally in contact with because all of my close circle of friends, except for a few whom I've always checked up on because I thought, okay, if they're in the same situation as me, I need to check up on these people more to make sure they're okay. But I didn't check up on people that I knew were home, even though they have been economically locked down at home, because I just assumed because their conditions are a lot better than mine, they had to be okay. And that's a very selfish way of looking at things. Because as we all learned from Chadwick Boseman's passing this weekend, people go through things, heavy things, things of a serious nature, and keep them to themselves and private all the time. But of course, because Chadwick is a celebrity, I don't know him, and of course, I wouldn't know of his that he was fighting cancer. But there were people that have gone on record since his passing saying, I became friends with Chadwick this past year. I spoke to him quite frequently, and not once did he ever mention that he was battling cancer. So never assume people you care about are doing fine. Just because when you speak to them or see them in person, they seem to be doing fine. Always mention if you are in a position to help them. Because I know not all of us are in a position to help others. But if you are in a position to help people you truly care about, make sure they understand that. Make sure you tell them if they need help, they will know. Because my best friends have explicitly told me that. They have said, I know how you are. I know that you're very self-reliant, but if you need my help at any time, know that you have it. That's super important for all of us to let other people know, because during this lockdown, checking in with a good friend, I even discovered a good friend is currently battling cancer, just like Chadwick Boseman, that I did not know about. Unfortunately, he's doing fine right now, but the crazy thing is I had no idea that he'd been dealing with it for a while. So I also used to keep things very close to my chest, very private when I was young, so I could have the weight of the world on my shoulders when I was younger. And my friends, if you would ask them how I was doing, would probably have described me as the happiest person in the world during these times, because I hid it from the rest of the world. Part of this was culture, because I grew up in a household, we didn't say I love you. It didn't mean my parents didn't love me. Of course they love me, but it's just something that happens in a lot of Asian households. Part of it was also being a man, because it's not manly to say I love you to someone else. Men say this, but in different ways, right? Like, I got your back, yo. You need help, let me know. I got you, brother, and so on. So ironically enough, the men that have shown me the most love in my life, like outside of fam, have been some of the hardest, toughest people I know. So they were my martial artists, brother in arms. Most were active duty military, and the ones that were not were living and exemplifying that warrior spirit lifestyle, like trying out to be Navy SEALs or something that we think is crazy. That's who my brother in arms martial artists were doing. So for example, whenever I missed class because I was dealing with personal issues or because I was really sick, one of my brothers from class would call to check, would not just call to check up on me, although some would call, only call, but others in my class would always express their concern in person. So they would sit me down and we talk about it face to face, even if it was just for 5-10 minutes. Or they would also swing by my crib, say I was really sick, and drop me off a hot meal. So we literally were like fam. So I'm not saying that you have to risk everything to try to change the world, because there are definitely great sacrifices that you would have to make if you're trying to change the world. But even small things like what I just described that I witnessed and experienced from my martial arts family are really important to do to retain our humanity. Believe me, you will be remembered forever for doing these things, as small and minute as you may think they are, because these things happened a long time ago. It's been a long time since I lived in Philly with my martial arts fam. So it's, you know, happened so long ago that it seems like a different lifetime, but yet I remember each and every instance of generosity, of real compassion, of real humanity shown me. So every kind thing someone has done in my entire life, I remember every single one. Even things that go back to high school, I still remember. Sometimes, like if I meet up with these all high school friends, I say, hey, remember that time when you really looked out for me? I really appreciate that. And sometimes my friends don't even remember. They're like, what? I don't remember that at all. And the reason they don't remember is because they're solid people who always do good things for people. So it's just one of probably thousands of things they've done that, you know, looking out for other people, so they have no memory of it. But yet, I guarantee you that all of the people they affected in a positive way will remember these things that they don't even remember. Okay, so before I move on, actually, I just had a thought. Kevin W., I don't want to say his last name, but he was a partner in crime with me during my martial arts days in Philadelphia. Man, I miss you, brother. And I've been trying to track you down for years, so anyone knows where he is, then please let me know, or please send him to this vid so we can get back in touch. And that was Kevin W from North Philly. Okay, so let me tell you another story about how important it is to retain our humanity. In college, my friend Sandy was killed in a car accident. And during a wake we held for her, I told a story about how I was racked with a bad fever 1 week and I couldn't get out of bed, and how Sandy visited me and brought me food, hung out with me, provided some companionship, and she did not even know me that well. I knew Sandy because I was good friends with her best friend, and her best friend did not even know this story. So that meant so much to me that she did that for me. It showed me what kind of human being Sandy was. And it also reminded me that we should not reserve our kindness just for people we consider to be our best friends. Even stone cold killers show love to people closest to them. We maintain this, that this is not how we maintain our humanity, just by showing our humanity to those that are very close to us. We maintain our humanity by extending kindness outside of our very close circle of fam and friends. Recently, one of the founders of GATA, the Gold Antitrust Association, extended a really kind gesture to me. GATA is spelled GATA, and their website is GATA.org. Now, we've communicated numerous times over the past years, but still we've never met in person. And the fact that he knew my situation and thereby did something really kind for me means a ton to me. So I've mentioned in the past that people that have made decent profits in your physical goal stacks, and I know some of you watching this have made really good profits in your goal stacks because you've been watching my channel forever. So you should consider, I'm asking you out of what I feel all of us should have as indebtedness to the selflessness of the founders of GATA, to donate something to GATA, because they're a nonprofit civil rights organization that relies on donations to educate the world about the sound money principles of gold. And they have been a primary pillar in the fight to free global gold pricing mechanisms against the bullion banker gold suppression schemes like gold spoofing. So if your physical gold stack has gone higher at any point, just doesn't have to be this year, it's gone higher since you bought in since 2016. You have to understand GATA has been one of the primary enablers of gold prices moving higher. So it's encourage you to visit their website at GATA.org and break them off a little something. Give back to show your appreciation for their tireless and selfless efforts. That, you know, because they have certainly taken their lumps as well in the fight against our immoral, unjust banking political machine. So we're living in extremely dangerous times right now, in these self-isolation bubbles being enforced upon us by the 0.1% ruling class that are specifically designed to make us hate one another, to increase our levels of animosity towards one another, specifically designed to strip us of our humanity. I've already gone into many times in previous videos how the ruling class are masters of psychological manipulation. But even if we are aware of their tactics, because I've been aware of their tactics for decades, we're still vulnerable to falling victim to them. I've had good friends to whom I've spoken to about this, whose minds I cannot change about the purpose of these economic lockdowns, and they still support their state mandates because they believe it's all about protecting our health instead of these state mandates of house arrest and mandatory face mask wearing being more about enforcing obedience and compliance to authority and for upholding their inequitable share of the global wealth pie. So while I understand their thinking completely, and this is not, you know, destroying our friendship, we can agree to disagree and be civil, which that's also seems to have gone out the window, people being able to have disagreements in a civil manner. I feel as if their conclusions are still non-science, non-fact based, because if they were science and fact based, I would side with them. And I also feel that their conclusions are only considering the impact upon their self-isolation bubble, meaning their immediate fam, and not the impact upon greater humanity, because we must have a greater vision for the world than just our little bubbles that we're being isolated in at this current time by the parasitic ruling class. Because if our decisions are based upon our self-isolating bubbles and the people that are within them, the ruling class is winning their battle to destroy our humanity. Because instead of being concerned about the 260 million people around the world that are rapidly moving towards starvation and the additional hundreds of millions of people around this world whose lives have been permanently financially destroyed because they're small business, because tens of millions of businesses have been destroyed. And so that will affect, of course, hundreds of millions of people. Because tens of millions of businesses being destroyed all around the world means that all the rest of the family members of the business owners will be affected, as well as all the employees. So that's literally hundreds of millions of people being financially ruined by these economic lockdowns. In addition, this is not including the 260 million people that are being moved to the brink of starvation, the edge of true suffering from hunger by this parasitic ruling class. So we may be moving towards billions of people, right, being pushed into economic misery and suffering by these lockdowns all around the world. But by getting people to focus all their attention inward instead of outward, which I believe the parasitic ruling class has really cleverly accomplished, this is destroying our humanity as it alleviates our concern for all our other brothers and sisters in this world. And this, the only way this focus can be turned inward instead of outward, or both inward and outward, because of course we never want to forget about, you know, those in our closest circle of friends. We can't just focus all our attention outward. It has to be inward and outward. It has to be bilateral in that sense. But because they've successfully achieved in getting us to focus all our attention inward, that can only be done through fear. And also a belief in the absurd, that this virus is, you know, they've gotten us to succumb to our fear because they've convinced us that this virus is 100 times more dangerous than it actually is in reality. So someone once said, once we can be convinced to believe in absurdities, then it's easy to convince these same people to commit atrocities. So that's why I say this loss of humanity that I'm observing, even in really good friends, is really dangerous. And the atrocities of which I'm speaking of are not overt manifestations of evil, like some people I know are going to become murderers and just shank people to death. I'm not speaking of that. The atrocities of which I speak about are getting people not to care about hundreds of millions of people that are silently being murdered by the parasitic ruling class because of these economic lockdowns. Because it is atrocious, I say it's an atrocity, because it's atrocious of us not to care about people just because we don't know them. They're not in our immediate circle of friends. And it is, by definition, everyone in the world are our brothers and sisters. And it's by definition not caring about our brothers and sisters to saying my life is more important than yours. Because I'm not in your situation, I lack empathy for what you're going through. So don't be like the 0.1%ers that we already know have zero empathy for anyone outside of their immediate family that love the psychological and economic suffering that they brought to this world through their lockdowns that they've imposed upon us. Because if you look at their situation, you must understand that lockdowns are inseparable from their desire to maintain the economic power in this world. Because a lot of people can't get that fact. They don't understand. They say, oh, no, this is just about protecting our health. So do you really think it's a coincidence that the very people that endorse these lockdowns, that their wealth grew by, I believe it was like $430 billion, almost $500 billion, while the wealth of the rest of the 99.9% of this world has been going down and in some cases been ravaged and destroyed and pillaged and raped? We must be smarter than to believe just what they say. And if we've not been adversely affected by the lockdowns economically, just to go along with their narratives, because these lockdowns, again, are inseparable from their desire to seize more power and more wealth. And just because they lie to us and say it's not inseparably tied to these their missions, we can't fall victim and be so naive and gullible to believe their lies. We cannot. We must not succumb to fear. The minute we support these economic lockdowns because of fear is the minute we lose our humanity. I guarantee you, because I know now it's even hard to recall a time when we were free to move about. But if you can recall a time, the last, say last summer, 2019, if you live north of the equator, or last winter, 2019, if you live south of the equator, when there were no economic lockdowns in the world, I guarantee you, if these state leaders, these governors, these mayors all returned us back to that state of freedom to move around tomorrow, people would not even know that there was an ongoing pandemic. And then the mass media didn't also participate in this fear campaign, and they stopped reporting on this pandemic completely. I guarantee you nobody would know that there's a pandemic going on. Why? Because from the scientific definition of a pandemic, from having mortality rates, not infection rates, mortality rates worthy of being called a pandemic, there is no pandemic going on. So if we just went back to life as normal, and it could be, the mortality rates will not go up, the more, you know, the real death rate. So nobody would even know that. That's the mind-blowing thing about what's going on with all these mandates and all these fines being now levied in Germany and all these other European countries if you're caught not wearing a mask. Now, let me give you another example of why we should not give in to fear. When I was fresh out of school, not even 21, because I graduated university, I was still 20 years old. I started mentoring 15 to 16 year old kids in the harshest, highest crime, most neighborhoods that had the highest rates of homicide per 100,000 people in Philadelphia. And people always have stereotypes about these kids, right? They say, oh, these kids are terrible. They're just a bunch of thugs. And I actually entered, because I'd never worked with kids like that before, with some of these stereotypes, like a little hesitant. But I was really surprised on the first day when all of them to a T addressed me as Mr. Kim. Because what? I'm only 5-6 years older than them. Because I was working with 15 and 16 year olds as, or 4 or 5 years older than them as a 20 year old. And again, that's not to say there are no thugs in these neighborhoods. There, you know, wasn't a shortage of them. But the kids that acted so thuggish with zero respect for adults or people older than them only acted that way because they didn't have a single responsible adult they had in their lives. They had absentee parents. And any adult that are not responsible adults themselves, that take no accountability for their own situation, should never have kids, because they're incapable of teaching kids the proper lessons in life to find meaning and purpose, to give meaning to their lives. Now, these were not the kids I grew up with. Although they only had single parents, moms, they had a responsible mom, most of them, not all of them. So one kid I still remember to this day, Wilbur, he said he saw 5 friends. He had already lost 5 good friends of his. And he actually witnessed 2 of them shot and murdered right in front of him. And he told me, he came to me, he's like, hey, can you help me start up the same program that you've done for us for like 10, 11 year old kids? Because he told me, you got to get to these kids like at 9 or 10 so they don't go through what I went through. And so I told all of them, because I really was quite impressed. And they showed me mad respect, because I kept telling them, just call me John. They would not. They would always, not a single one of them ever called me John. Even though every time I saw them, just said, just call me John. It's not because I'm trying to be your friend, but you don't have to call me Mr. Kim. And I gave these kids, all of them, my home number. Said, you get in trouble, you need a place to lay low for a couple days. My home's open. You get in trouble, you need my help. Doesn't matter. 2 in the morning on a Wednesday night, call me. I'm there for you, man. And some of my friends said, hey, yo, that's crazy. What are you doing? You're inviting danger to your doorstep. And I said, my answer to them is I refuse to live in fear. I choose to view the situation the opposite from how you're viewing it. It's not that I'm inviting danger to my doorstep. I'm inviting these kids that might if they feel they have no resource, no adult to help them out, that might make a bad decision and die. So I choose to view the situation as, perhaps if I can do anything to give these kids a chance at life, that's what I want to do, instead of having them do something that will bring down their, you know, usher in their downfall and then cause their lives to end. So, you know, also when I grew up in Philly, I remember hanging out with one of my friends from school. We were walking home from a movie, a homeless person stopped us, and she had to stop because she was with me, and she freaked out, right? And I couldn't understand why she was freaking out. And when I asked her after we left, she said, like, you don't know what that guy could have done. He could have like really hurt us or something. And I said, look, that guy you saw had a really gentle demeanor. His eyes were not all methed out. He wasn't on drugs. Like, I sized him up really quickly. If he was, I would have walked away, because I knew he was harmless. I said, the reason I stopped and talked to him, and I said, look, I've been in Philly for a while, so I know all these street schemes to mug people. I know people ask you for the time, because when you are distracted for that split second when you look at your watch, then they'll whack you over the head, knock you out, steal your wallet. I know people like have they work in tandem, ask you for directions while you're distracted looking, addressing this one person, another person come up behind you, knock you over the head, knock you out. I said, I know these things. I know too. I looked around, no one else was with him, was working with it. No one was within 100 meters of where we were. I looked at him, I sized him up. He was not a threat. And I said, the reason I spoke and talked to him, even though the few bucks I gave him to buy a meal is not gonna change his life, it's important that we don't lose our humanity. You know, because more people rescue animals than rescue humans to this day. And that says a lot about our lost state of humanity, that more people are willing to rescue dogs than rescue a human being. And even though I said, like, what I did is not going to rescue him, it's important for that person to realize that there are people out there that still see him as a human being. If nobody sees him as a human being, he loses all faith in humanity. Do you think he's ever going to get off the streets? He'll never get off the streets. So it's important for us not to lose our humanity out of fear, especially when someone is not, like, poses no threat to us. So when I was young, I really didn't like to ask for help, because I thought it was a sign of weakness. I was so used to solving every problem on my own, and I thought mistakenly that I was strong because, hey, I solved everything by myself and no help from any of my friends. But as I matured, I learned the exact opposite was true. It was accepting help from others, working with others, giving back to others that helped me when I got back on my feet. That is what made me strong. And ironically, as I stated also, some of the toughest men I knew were the ones, the highly skilled martial artists, that taught me these lessons. So I also realized that the sacrifices I had made in life, things I've spoken about in the past, like speaking about topics like sound money on my former YouTube channel that got me banned by Google, that destroyed my last business, I thought at the time was a huge sacrifice. And I learned over time, when I learned what real sacrifice is about, that was really only a tiny sacrifice. Because one of my friends that was a key figure in the anti-apartheid movement in South Africa was arrested, tortured, and spent 12 years in prison so that his country could be free, and that his brothers and sisters, who he did not even know, could be free. That is true sacrifice. That is true love of humanity. What I do know for 100% certainty is that love is stronger than fear. So that's why I'm harping so much about not giving into fear, not ruling our lives by fear, because I feel everyone that supports this economic lockdown, the rules are being their lives, so I can't even speak, I just transpose those two words, their lives are being ruled by fear, and they're willing to sacrifice their humanity to live in fear. You can't outguess God. Sometimes there's a greater plan in store for us. We can't understand the bad things that happen to us, but who knows, maybe my last business being destroyed was a good thing, even though it seemed like the worst possible thing that could have happened in my life at that time, is I had to start at ground zero, spend another few years with 14-hour days every day with no break, even on the weekends, building up this other business I'm trying to launch. And then right when I was getting ready to launch it in April, the lockdowns happened. I haven't been able to launch my business because I've been like locked out of my home country where I need to be to launch my business. So people say, how can you not lose your humanity and faith in humanity in this? Because if we lose our humanity, we might as well give up on life. So once we lose our humanity, lose faith in other people's humanity, life is done. It's over. But as long as we keep these two things in our lives and nurture them, power and integrity will always win in the end. So how do we keep these things going? It's easy. Don't give in to the absurdity of fear, because living your life based upon decisions driven by fear is absurd. So my message is simple. Don't lose your humanity. Defy, resist, fight, love. Don't allow darkness to shrink your true nature. My martial arts teacher used to make us all spar in seiza position, which is a position where you're on your knees, right? So we get down on our knees and then fight with our upper body and our hands. So to move around our sparring partner, we're only allowed to monkey walk. And all martial artists will know what monkey walking is, where it's basically just walking on your knees. So the reason he made us do this said, if you learn to be super effective in fighting with your upper body in seiza position, when you stand up, think about how easy it is going to fight on your feet. That will be a cakewalk. So I feel like right now we're all in seiza position, right? The parasitic ruling classes have brought us all temporarily to our knees. But instead of giving into that, we need to learn how to be efficient. When we've been subdued, we need to nurture our power in darkness. And if we learn to shine in darkness, think about how easy it will be to shine in light. Okay, so that concludes my message. Please spread this message to everyone you know. And then I'll leave you with a 2-minute montage that is kind of replicates the themes of this podcast. Always remain intensely curious. Thanks so much for watching to the end. I really appreciate all of you that watched to the very end. Please comment below, actually, if you watched the very end. I want to know like how many people I reach with this entire podcast, as far as, because like I said at the beginning, I think this is one of the most important messages that I forwarded in the past several weeks. So I hope everyone watched to the end so they can forward the same message on to everyone they know. Bless up.